my name is Denny Griffith. I'm Director of External Affairs here at the Columbus Museum of Art. And today we're going to take a look at two wonderful exhibitions that deal with landscape, a show called Landscape as Metaphor, Visions of America in the Late 20th Century, and The Landscape Tradition, a show of 60-some works selected from the museum's permanent collections to take a look at the historical importance of landscape in the growth and evolution of the art of our time. I'd like to start today with a look at some works that are hanging here in the Ross Wing of the museum that are hung here basically to help viewers or visitors to the exhibition understand the importance of landscape. With the Landscape as Metaphor show, we have commissioned 13 contemporary artists to do works of art that all somehow respond to the idea of landscape, which is to say, their works generally don't depict landscape as much as they have, they're inspired by landscape, let's say. In the Landscape Tradition show, with works such as the one that we see here by Giovanni Moroni, this is a 15th century painting that depicts St. Agnes. Now, so many people might look at this and say, well, gosh, you know, where's the landscape here? It seems to me that the subject matter is actually St. Agnes, and lo and behold, it's true. Here on the right-hand side of the painting, you see her holding a lamb, and in the background, of course, the land is presented. This was done at a time in which artists were just beginning to make the transition from painting what we call sacred subjects to what we call secular subjects. What is that? Well, if you think about it, what artists were doing at the time was depicting the world around them, seeking to represent that world. And of course, the great patron for artists, the organization that sponsored the works that the artists would do or would purchase them was the church. So through the Renaissance, up until the time, actually past the time when Columbus discovered America, 1492, up to the time of this painting, which is almost 100 years later, 1570s, artists were really encouraged to only deal with subjects that dealt with sacred material, because the church was the sponsor. So by the mid-1600s, you see pictures that show people lounging around, maybe having a picnic. You see the beautiful forests, and so nature is depicted in these scenes not so much as a threat, but as bountiful and as rich and as nurturing. And so in a number of the pictures in the galleries that we'll walk through here today, what you'll see is that artists' relationship to the world around them changed, and it changed according to the dictates of the time in which they lived. And that's really the case with landscape as metaphor as well. What viewers will see a little later in the program today is the ways in which artists have always responded to the world in which they live. They tell us about that world. It's one of the roles that artists have historically had, and we can see it played out in the works in this preliminary exhibition, The Landscape Tradition. Looking at the next several pictures in the series, we move into the mid to late 1800s. And if you stop and think about what was going on in the world at that time, in 1839, photography was invented. So you have a period in which it's the beginnings of setting the stage for the Industrial Revolution. Europe had a whole class of people that were the laboring class, and they had other classes that were the more privileged class. And so mankind's relationship to nature, humankind's relationship to nature, you can kind of track that in the works that were being done at the time. But the thing that really strikes me so strongly about the pictures that we look at is that the light is what's so important. The artists, by this point, were extremely facile at depicting the landscape. You still occasionally see the symbol of, in this picture and the next one, the church spire is still there. So in a sense, we never really get away from artists kind of metaphorically trying to sort out humankind's relationship, not only to the world around them, but to the Almighty. And so that, even if it's just a church spire, we're still reminded that we live in the world, we're of the world, but there's also this whole other element. And what we really see very clearly in these pictures is the importance of the light, which I think to some degree is attributable to the fact that photography had been invented. These artists had seen photographs, they saw the way that it represented the light, and I think that attitude starts to show up in the work. So now we're going to take a big jump forward. We go from the 1870s to the 1880s and 1890s, and we're entering now the age, the wonderful age that we all love so much, called Impressionism. We have several Monets on the wall here, and what you can see in this work is by the late 1800s, where we start to get into the 1900s, what artists are doing is using that light, and rather than just depicting the world around them, they're beginning to manipulate our view of the world. And this is an important change. What happens at this time is that artists begin to record their impressions by closely bunching dabs and dots of paint with vivid colors in ways that the feelings that we get are just really, it runs the gamut, an incredible range of feelings, but the color and the light, the saturation of that color is what brings all of us to Impressionism, and it's probably one of the most beloved art movements that there is. When we think of Monet, we think of Van Gogh, we think of the people that are getting such expressive qualities out of that landscape, it's because of that wonderful juicy texture to the paint and the way that the colors just vibrate so much. We've talked about Impressionism, here we have Expressionism. The Expressionists, the German Expressionists by and large came out of Northern Europe, Germany, Belgium and so on, and these artists were really they were influenced by the Impressionists. You see bright color, but you also see that the way that they paint, they've reduced these images down to their basic expressive elements. And so with someone like Soutine, if you think about this landscape in which the houses are all twisted and the hills are jumbled up, this is right at the time, in 1923, after the close of the First World War. So here's an artist who lived through the First World War, saw what it did to Europe, was influenced and inspired by the work of his colleagues, and was taking this very expressive kind of approach to creating the, you know, to recreating the world around him. You see that feeling that the artists are after is one that's less about the impressions of things than their own manipulation, their own expressiveness, and so that's borne out in the work. One of the points I wanted to make today is that the art of our time, contemporary art, certainly art post-1945, which would be after the Second World War. With the abstract expressionists, we saw a giant landscape of simple colors that had been boiled down to its basic elements. And so often with art that gets more and more recent, closer to our own lifetimes, we see that unlike the artists of the early days that were in a sense trying to capture the whole world around them and somehow record it and represent it to us, contemporary artists from the modern time period, or what we call modernism and beyond, tend to focus in and be what I'd call reductive. They want to get a single idea across and present that very carefully. And so with the abstract expressionists, it was about feeling and color and brushstroke that we saw in that big landscape, and the color was really probably the biggest clue to the fact that it is a landscape. That notion of those kinds of ideas became even more important by the late 60s and 70s when a whole group of artists became interested not only in how the work was done, but almost more importantly, what the ideas behind the artwork were. And this is something that we see a lot of today, and we're going to see quite a bit of in landscape as metaphor. Walter de Maria and people that he knew of and worked with, like Robert Smithson and Michael Heiser, a number of these people did what we would call earthworks. What that means is instead of doing their work of art on the canvas or on top of a pedestal made out of bronze, these guys went out into the world and they, in a sense, charged a piece of land with meaning by manipulating it. So for those of us in the art world, we'd look at this stuff and say, well, this is art just as much as a painting that hangs on the wall is art. So what this artist has done is he's painting, if you will, he's sculpting an entire piece of land, he's turning that piece of land into a work of art. It's the hand of humankind transforming the real world. So by this moment, what we see is the idea behind the work of art becomes the work of art. And it's because of people like this that we see that the idea of the concept is what really drives it. And that's the concept is what's behind so much of the work in landscape as metaphor. So let's go inside here and take a look at the first piece from the exhibition. It's by an artist named Mel Chin. Mel has created a room for us here. Join me. This piece is called Spirit. And as you look around, what you'll see is that there's pressed up against the ceiling of the room here is a one-ton oak barrel. That barrel is at least 10 feet across. It's made out of white oak, and it's balancing here on a one-inch thick rope that's made of prairie grass. Now, the artist went to the Nature Conservancy in Topeka, Kansas. The Nature Conservancy is a wonderful nonprofit organization that protects areas of land that might be endangered by purchasing them and holding them in trust for the public. So this rope that the artist made here is made out of grasses from the vanishing prairies. Even the room here was all designed by the artist. You'll notice if you look down here that the walls are built with a slight curvature to them. And so when you walk into this dark room with its little pools of light, the impression you have is that this giant barrel is maybe slowly pulling the walls in. So how do we read this work? What's the text of the piece? Well, let's think for a moment. The piece is called Spirit. This barrel, at the time of the whole westward expansion into the United States, was the primary way that settlers had for transporting things like whiskey, gunpowder, foodstuffs, grain. This was the way that people carried the things that they needed out into the great American West. And so as our nation, our growing nation, began its expansion, what we had is that these barrels were what fed the armies, they fed the settlers. These barrels were on Conestoga wagons, and they were on barges, and I suppose they were even in it couldn't have been taken on horseback, but certainly they were the way that things were transported. So we have this enormous, fat, engorged symbol of that westward expansion precariously balanced on this inch-thick rope. And so what the artist is saying to us here is that as humankind moved out west, what happened was that the prairies were shrunken to just a last vestige of themselves. You know, the prairies are very nearly gone. Virgin prairie land is hard to find in our country anymore, and in fact it's one of the reasons that the Nature Conservancy has purchased areas of it to keep it in its original state. So the artist is then saying to us, look, this piece is about this westward expansion, and he asked the question historically, what's been the cost? Well, the cost is that the prairies have been reduced down to a thin green line, and that thin green line in this case is this wonderful rope. So it's a great piece, it's a wonderful illusion, and you got to ask yourself the question, how do they keep that barrel balanced up there on that rope? It's pretty sneaky, isn't it? We are going to look at a wonderful piece by Ursula von Reidingsvard. Ursula is an artist who lives in New York City. The piece is called Schlepa Zhenya. Now that's my best pronunciation of it. It actually is the name of a Polish children's game, and Ursula is actually born in Europe and then raised here in the United States. She always works with wood, with laminated cedar beams. And so these shapes that we see here, as you look down across them, I'm sure it begins to look to you like mountains, like ridges and valleys. And so you can begin to see that even if we don't at first understand what these objects are, the color and the texture, and if you could only smell across your TV screen, you would know that this room has a wonderful aroma of cedar wood. So the clues for what this piece is about, for starters, are in the textures and the colors. But once you take a look not only at the whole room, but you begin to hone in on the individual pieces, what you find is that each of these is a kind of a boat form. And so what Ursula has done here is she's laminated these cedar beams together, and at either end you see some kind of handles or something. So these are, maybe they're canoes, but maybe they're also like a litter, like a stretcher would be for carrying someone who's injured. Or maybe they're, it seems like there could be lots of things. And as I mentioned earlier, that's one of the hallmarks of a lot of contemporary art. But notice something. Here inside the boat, there's a form, two legs kind of like, and a torso, and it goes up to a head, just very generally outlined. You know how you make snow angels? If you lay on your back in the snow and you make a little mark, well, in a sense, there's the impression recorded in each one of these pieces. Every one of these things has these two legs and a kind of a body form. So the size of the vessel is informed by human scale. And where these come from is that the artist has a studio assistant, a fellow by the name of Bart, who's a big Norwegian guy. I'm 6'5", and so Bart is at least as tall as I am, only he's a lot heavier. He's a very muscular guy. And once Ursula gets the bottom layer of the wood laid down, then she lays Bart down on top of it, and she traces around him really roughly. So printed in the bottom of each one of these canoe shapes, you'll see those two legs and that torso. And so in a sense, these pieces contain a memory of humanity. And in that way, I think it's wonderful the way she ties together the forms. We're going to move straight across the hall to a pretty extraordinary piece by Meg Webster called Hollow Cone. Now, here in this gallery, when you walk in, suddenly, extraordinarily, there's a mountain. And you know, this mountain form is also, it's so perfectly, almost like machined, that you can't, I mean, it's strangely familiar. And here again, the aroma, you'll have to come down to the museum to see this. To walk into the museum gallery and to smell this moist earth, this wonderful sort of familiar garden smell, it's very surprising. But the cone is hollow. And what she's done here is she's created a space inside the cone, much like a Native American teepee, where we can go inside. I hate to keep talking about this, the smells, but boy, the smells in this thing are great. The walls are made out of cedar. And you know, I don't know if you've ever been up in the attic of a house, like maybe you've been to your grandmother or grandfather's house, or maybe your own house, but this always reminds me a little bit of coming into an attic. Feels kind of safe, and again, the smell is so wonderful. Now, Meg Webster has done two different kinds of sculpture, basically. She's done planted gardens in urban settings, like downtown New York City or in the Bronx, or sometimes next door to art museums or university art galleries. She's created places where food is grown in urban environments and homeless people can come and gather the food, or she's often created sites where she tries to recreate the vegetation the way it would have been before humankind came on the scene. So you might find in a city a wonderful garden of material that really is indigenous to the area but that can no longer be found there because of what we've done to the earth. Meg also creates these kinds of what I'd call sculpture that are real basic forms that use that kind of natural garden material to make a work of art. Well, next we've got this wonderful treat. This is another piece that's temporarily installed, that could be taken apart actually and installed somewhere else. And that is, watch behind you there. A piece by Judy Pfaff. Judy also lives in New York City, and she's very interested in working with recycled and found materials. If you look in here, there are these kind of spider webs of this wonderful glass. I'm not going to touch this because it's very fragile, but this is actually not recycled. This is stuff that she made here out of polyester resin, which is a liquid plastic that goes over strands of fiberglass, and it's basically the way we make speedboats or even skateboards, Corvette car bodies and that sort of thing. But she's created this kind of spun glass spider web. But you'll see tree trunks, and if we kind of walk carefully here in between the cords, you can come around here and you can see that what she's done is she's turned an upside down tree and she's hung hoses and things that she's found and old pieces of rusty wire. But the thing that's so amazing about this to me is that Judy, in creating this kind of world here, chose to remove the ceiling here in the gallery and took the piece up into the rafters of the museum. And up in there you can see floating objects and more of that polyester resin stuff. And way up high, lights and the silvery tubes that are the museum's heating and ventilation system. So we're going to move from Judy Pfaff's Cielo Recuerdo into Richard Mizrach's world of photography in the next gallery. Mizrach is a photographer. Everything that you see in this room, these 17 photographs, were taken at the Bonneville Salt Flats in Utah. It's a place where each year, water during the wintertime, I'm told, runs down and sort of covers the surface. And then by spring, the water evaporates, and there are these almost endless salt flats, this very flat, hard-packed white surface. And for quite some time, it's been a place where the world land speed record trials have taken place. And so we've got a suite of photographs here that the artist has done, where he's gone there when they're doing the land speed trials, and he's looking around, he's finding things happening, and he's snapping photographs of them. So here you see this kind of very odd, surreal diner set up. And if you look over here, you can see that they're getting ready to sell Coke and probably some hot dogs to the guys who are driving the cars or the people who are coming to watch the cars. And here's this kind of funny relationship between the land and the mountains and humankind. And so once again, you've got an artist who's trying to sort out in very contemporary terms, what's our relationship with that world? You know, here's a kid with a, you know, a baseball cap and a bit of a tail hanging down there, and he's got blades on, and he's looking out over miles and miles and miles of this salt flat. But just remember, less than 140 years ago, crossing this very same place was the Donner Party. If you remember the story about the Donner Party, were headed out to California. They stopped here in Utah, then they went up into the mountains, and tragically, a number of their party died. They ran out of food, and it was cold. And they had to resort to cannibalism, and so it's kind of a black mark in our nation's history, and sort of a tale that depicts the struggle of how difficult it was to get through the West. But here, you know, in a very short period later, you've got sort of contemporary versions of not so much cowboys, but if you think that one of the Donner Party could have been standing in this very spot in his buckskins or her skirt and bonnet just 150 years or so ago before, then it starts to make us realize that our relationship to this world changes very, very quickly. We're going to go into a piece here that's meant to be listened to as well as looked at. And in it, we'll hear the voice of a Kahuilla elder telling the story of Takwish, an ice spirit. I'm going to be quiet for a moment and just let you listen to the voice moving around the room and the dripping water of these enormous blocks of ice that are on either end of the table. You will note that in the room there's a long table, and at either end of the table are there's a 300-pound block of ice. It melts, and it melts down into this vessel that's beneath the table. It's a Native American form, and you can see the water dripping here. Every 5 days, we have to replace the ice. It melts down to a small, almost the size of a loaf of bread, and then we replace it. In the room, you hear the sound, the recorded voice of Alvino Siva, who's an elder in the Kahuilla tribe, who was a childhood friend of the artist's father. And in Kahuilla, he's telling us about the legend of Takwish, who lives out in the mountains and will come along and steal people's soul, and when he does, he eats that soul, and that's what kills them. We see a videotape of the actual mountain where Takwish is believed to live by the Kahuilla people. Now, learning the story of Takwish, when you come down to the museum to see this, there's Mr. Siva talking, can be learned in the translator, which is on the other side of this wall here. The translator is this table, and if you look at it here, there's a map of the San Jacinto peak, a topographical map of the actual place. And if we watch closely here, I don't know if it's going to work with the lights on or not, you'll see the letters, the story rises up mysteriously out of that surface. So the artist has created a piece here in which the story, written in English, so that translated so we can understand it, what I'm saying in Cahuilla is that I'm going to tell what I know about our demigod, Taquish, that was constructed by Mukat, our creator, many years ago, and bad things that he has done to our people. Years ago, when we were created, Mukat created shamans, powerful shamans. Some of them were demigods. Anyway, he goes on and he tells the story. And so these words rise and fall. They drift out of our sight and they rise back up to the surface. And that's how we learn what the meaning of the piece is. For years and years, Ed Ruscha has incorporated words into his pictures, usually very simple paintings with a kind of maybe a mountain or a background with words floating in them. And these are many of these were inspired by, first of all, Ed Ruscha lives on the West Coast. He lives in Venice, California, which is in the Hollywood area. And early on, he was fascinated with that very famous Hollywood sign that's up on the hills up above LA. The big letters Hollywood are spelled out. And he did a series of paintings in which he did paintings of the Hollywood sign, basically. Over time, he became fascinated with the way that language works in pictures, and so he's typically incorporated language into the pieces he does. Now here we have three very, very long, skinny paintings. Ruscha calls them his rubber band paintings. They're stretched way out, impossibly thin, impossibly long. And from this picture, as I try to read it, I get the sense of, first of all, the colors are very muted. It's almost like it's dusk. And perhaps we're speeding along through the desert. You know, you imagine going through the down a desert highway at dusk, and you glance out your side window, and what do you see? But this kind of world racing by, very dark, the sun setting, and then there's this kind of weird, sort of UFO-like shape up here. What is this? Well, these words that are painted on here are painted anamorphically, and if you come down here, as you're doing, and sight down along that, what you'll see is that you can read this word, it all of a sudden comes into focus. And the word in this case is scratch, S-C-R-A-T-C-H, scratch. The title of the painting is Scrub Scratch. Scrub is in desert scrub, it's a kind of thin, tough vegetation. Scratch is in a sandy soil. Turning around here, the next painting, land. And what you see is it seems to be almost completely black, almost like asphalt. And as you move down it, you begin to notice just subtle variations in the texture. But standing down at the end, you can read the word L-A-N-D. I want to thank you for taking time today to walk through these exhibitions with me. Landscape as Metaphor and the Landscape Tradition are on view at the Columbus Museum of Art through the 5th of March, 1995. The museum is open Tuesday through Sunday. The phone number here is 221-6801. Please give us a call, come visit. This is your museum, and thanks for watching.